Hello, Ben.
Hey Matt, how you doing?
I'm well, how are you?
Welcome to the podcast. Yeah, I'm all right.
It's been like I think at least 2 years since I've done anything like this.
Really?
I used to be I used to be like really prolific online on social media, doing interviews and making videos. I've over 1,000 videos on YouTube and I used to do a lot of stuff, and I used to do interviews with people on their different like podcasts and things like that. And I just haven't done anything for about 2 years. So when you contacted me and said, do you want to do a podcast? I thought, well, I have to really think, because over the last few years I've had children, and my focus has been taken so much from that and to them, and then suddenly you have to really sort of triple your income to afford a lifestyle. I'm living over in Spain, and if I want to put them in a proper school, or not a proper school, but in a private school and things like that. And suddenly it's like, oh wow, I've got to really do what brings the money in, where before it didn't really matter. I had my YouTube channel, and I had like an online membership site, and Standing Health Now, my YouTube channel Be Your Potential. I could live off it and make money off it and things like that, but there's nothing like really sort of like serious, nothing seriously big. And then suddenly the responsibilities of two children, that's it's like, wow, it's huge, especially when you're not in a secure sort of career or something like that, where you're just sort of like winging it through, if you know what I mean.
I do know what you mean. Martial arts is important to you, I think.
I started, well, let me just, I guess, tell some stories, I guess, I started in martial arts at the age of seven. I went to my first karate class. I grew up with quite a bit of intimidation around me, and so martial arts, first of all, was to I wanted to be able to defend myself, in real life situations. So that's why I started. I loved it. So I kept going with it. I was also inspired by the big screen actors. I was inspired by Bruce Lee, and so I watched a lot of martial arts flicks as a kid, and used to go out in the garden and practice all the moves afterwards. And I was really inspired by it. Any day I came home from school, I had a training center set up in my garden. I used to go out and just hit bags and throw kicks and condition my knuckles and things like that. So right from an early age, I was doing stuff like that when, all the other kids were, I don't know, out kicking a ball around or whatever they're doing. I don't know. I was punching bags and trying to condition my knuckles and doing press ups and things. Then I progressed with that. Anywhere we lived, I just joined the local martial arts club. I did kickboxing through my teenage years. And did Kung Fu, Taekwondo. Then I joined the Marines when I was 18. And about that, no?
No.
Okay, let me back up then. Let me back up, because that's an interesting story, and I think something that could be taken value from it, at the age of five, I've always had, one of the reasons health was such a high priority to me was because it was a void that I had when I was a child. At the age of five, I was diagnosed with what's commonly known as asthma, so I was like puffing on an inhaler from that age every single day, and it never let up, So every single day of throughout my childhood, throughout my teenage years, I had to have this inhaler everywhere I went. I couldn't have if I went to school without it, I was done. I needed to have it, and I was always overdosing on it. I was puffing on it like three times, four times, five times as much as you're meant to, just because I needed it, and so if you've ever experienced breathing difficulties, it's a bitch. When you can't breathe, nothing else is right, so your health isn't right, nothing else is right. You can't enjoy anything when you can't breathe. And so I was looking for ways to get rid of it, so But it didn't go away, and I always had this dream and this dream to be an elite soldier, and it was just one of my dreams. I had a few of them, but that was one of my dreams. And so when I was a teenager, where the careers people came into the school and they said, "What do you want to do?" And I said, "Well, I'd want to join the Royal Marines." And they said, "Okay." And then my teachers were asking me, "Well, what are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to join the Royal Marines." And they said, "Well, you can't, you've got asthma, because I was puffing on this thing all the time, so everybody knew." My PE teacher said, "Well, you can't complete the cross country run. How can you can't do it, But I always trained hard, but I always just needed the inhaler to be with me, And so then I went to my doctor and I said, is there anything you can do? Can you give me some steroids or something, whatever?" And he's like, "Well, I can put you on a stronger inhaler, but I think you just gotta find a different career choice." But I just wasn't having it, and then my family didn't think I could do it. My friends said, "Well, there's no way you can do that." So everyone around me was telling me what I couldn't do, I just had this, I don't know, stubborn, unreasonable attitude, and I said, "Well, no matter what everyone else says, I'm just going to do it anyway." But the truth is that I could not run more than a mile without stopping, all my tubes closing up, and needing to puff on this inhaler. And in the Royal Marines, the commando tests are, pretty extreme. You have to run for 30 miles with a pack on your back and your rifle over your shoulder, and over undulating countryside, and do all these different really arduous physical tests. And so I would go for a 4 mile run and have to stop three or four times for 5 minutes at a time to get my breath, to take my inhaler, to wait for my tubes to open up again. And of course, you can't join the Royal Marines when you have asthma. You're a liability. What if you have an asthma attack when you're in the field, or on some sort of mission or something? It's not acceptable. So, but I had this desire. It was just like this really deep burning desire that I was going to do this no matter what. And I had this very strange belief that I could do it, even though the outside world, and even my body was telling me that I couldn't do it, So with this desire and with this belief, I just plowed on forward, and I just started taking massive action, in the form of, I just trained my ass off, all day, any chance I could. I was cycling to and from work, 36 miles a day. I was spending 2 hours in the gym every day. I was doing this, 4 to 6 mile run through the forest, where I would also pick up a huge log and put it on my shoulder and run for a while with it. Then I also had my martial arts training that I did. I was just like, any chance I could, I was just training, But the thing was that I was still needing to puff on my inhaler every single day without fail from the age of 5 to the age of 18. And so then it got to the stage where I'd gone up and I did my tests, my written tests, did my medical. And just before I did my medical, I puffed on my inhaler about 20 times just to stop any wheezing in my chest, because the doctor puts a stethoscope on your chest, And I was just like sitting there crossing my fingers and praying that, that he wouldn't detect the wheeze. And lucky enough, I passed the medical, and then I had to go over for, then it got to the stage where, I was going, I got in basically, I got in, it was like coming up to my join date, but I still had this problem. I still had this like knot in my chest that just wasn't going away. And so it got to the point where I just thought, wow, I'm doing everything I can. I'm giving it 100%. I don't know anything else I can do within myself, And so I got to this point where I was out for a run in the forest, and I just stopped because my chest tightened up again, because I had this mindset and I visualized myself doing the run, and I visualized everything as well. Another big thing was visualization. I was visualizing myself being in the Royal Marines. I was visualizing myself receiving the Green Beret and all that stuff as well. I kept on visualizing, kept on visualizing it. And this is before I'd done any sort of personal development stuff, I just had an understanding of the power of visualization. So I was running through the forest, and I really visualized hard that I was going to run through the forest without needing my inhaler. So I got halfway through, and suddenly everything tightened up, and I had to stop, puff on my inhaler. And I was like, oh my God, I just said, I cannot do this by myself. And that's when I asked for help, I just got down on my knees in the middle of the forest, and I said, I cannot do this by myself. And that was my realization. And I said, I need some help. And so I was never brought up religious or anything. I never stepped foot into a church until I was 12, and I just did it to see what it looked like. But I always believed in a creator. I always believed that I've been created by some intelligence that is vastly greater than I am. So that's what I prayed to this creator, and I said, I can't do this by myself. I need some help. I'm just going to give this everything I got. Just please help me. And it got right up to the point where I was had my plane tickets. I was getting on my pl getting on the plane, and I took my inhaler, and just before I got on the plane, and that was the last time I needed it for 4.5 years.
So you just didn't need it anymore.
I just didn't need it anymore. The asthma just disappeared. So I had had it for so 10, 11, 12, tw 12 years. 12 years without stopping. 12 years without having one day without that inhaler, and I'm being really reliant on it.
So what do you believe? Do you believe there's some kind of divine intervention? Like, what do you think happened?
I believe it's a combination of things, I believe that was the breakthrough. I believe that was the breakthrough, but I believe that breakthrough happened through all everything I'd put in before that. I think I'd done my bit. I'd done everything I could. I don't think so. Sometimes we just go, okay, I'm just going to pray for it, and it's going to come to me. I think you just got to give it everything you have, and at the same time, also ask for help. So yeah, that's what I believe. I believe that it was that, or my unconscious mind is just so powerful that it did something. But I believe in a creator, and I believe that's what just took it away, took that like knot out of my chest, and allowed me to breathe easily. And it was a bit like Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump has these like things on his legs, that prevents him from running, and so eventually, once he breaks through them, once he gets these things off, they've actually strengthened his legs so much that he's able to run like the wind, And it was a similar sort of thing. I had this like weight on my chest for so long that once it was taken off, suddenly my fitness went through the roof.
Right, because your lungs had been working so hard under the disadvantage that they were stronger than like when athletes train in a with a mask on and stuff.
I guess quite like that. And so I ended up getting the PT award in my troop, and I got the
PT?
assault course record. I got the part like the physical training award.
All right, okay.
Yeah, I got the for my troop. I got the physical training award. I got the assault course record that year. So I did the assault course faster than about 500 other Marines. So it was quite significant, the change, from someone who a year before could not run a mile without stopping and taking an inhaler to getting the assault course record out of really stiff competition.
Yeah.
So so it gave me a really strong reference that about the power of the mind and you know how we can overcome. And so I don't think it was just, you know, whether a person is, it doesn't matter what your spiritual religious belief is, you know, whether a person is, you know, atheist or whatever, just call it the power of your unconscious mind then, you know? And I believe it was just these things that just, if you have like a really strong burning desire to do something, you can believe you can do it, you visualize it, you have this attitude that is just, you know, completely unreasonable, where, and to have an unreasonable attitude is just to where, you know, all the voices on the outside, no matter what they say, the voice on the inside is more powerful than that, you know, more certain than that. So your internal voice is, if your internal voice is more certain than what everyone else is telling you around you, then that's what's important, you know, not to get swayed by other influences. And sometimes that can seem delusional, and sometimes it is. But I think it's when it's coupled with a clear purpose and a strong desire to do something, I don't know, empowering. I think that's different, you know.
What was your diet like during the period when you had asthma?
In that time, you know, By the way, the symptoms of asthma came back, and I'll tell you exactly when they came back. Mm-hmm. They came back. It was either the day or that week that I handed my notice in to leave the Royal Marines. Mm. So four and a half years later, when I handed my notice in, that's when it came back.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
It hadn't been a problem the whole time you were in the Marines.
No.
How weird.
Yeah. So there's more going on than we realise, you know.
Have you ever done ayahuasca?
Just a bit.
Oh, you have?
I've done over 200 ceremonies.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That's a lot. So, okay. So, when did that start? When did you get into that?
It was 2004, I think.
Oh, right, long time ago.
Yeah, before you know, it's like ayahuasca is like mainstream now. It's like cool, you know. I'm, you know, to go and do it. But way before, pretty much anyone knew about it. When it just really come to Europe and the UK and Ireland, anyway. I was introduced to it then, and I got involved with a group of people who were doing it very, very regularly. And then I became an assistant in the ceremonies. So I was, for most of those ceremonies, I was like an assistant in them, you know. So I went all over the world doing it. I went over to Brazil and into the jungle and the forests and up into the mountains and, you know, over the UK and over to Holland and Spain and Wales and everywhere. And
were you assisting one particular teacher?
Not one particular teacher. No, not one person, but it was a group. It was a group of people from Brazil, like a lineage of people from Brazil that do ayahuasca, and it's called the Santo Daime. And I worked with them.
That's been a big part of your life then.
Yeah, for 7 years I was full on at it, you know. When I was in Ireland, since being in Spain, I haven't done it so much. But it was a big part of my life, yeah.
And so, what impact did that have on you?
The story is I was married when I was 24. And I had about a year and a half later, we got married very young. I was very, I guess, naive and things like that, you know. I thought once you get married, that's it. forever. You're done, you know? And maybe I took my eye off the ball a bit. I didn't really understand the relationship dynamics and things like that. I wanted to travel, so I took her traveling and things like that. And she didn't actually want to travel, you know? And I didn't really see it. So after about a year, she said, I've had enough of this. It's not what I want. And she walked out, and I had a breakdown, you know? And so I was, went into a deep depression, and I just couldn't seem to really get out of it or let go of her. I was deeply depressed. And at the same time, I was attached. I was energetically attached to her, you know, and she had a lot of baggage too, you know. And it got to the point where I was. That's when I was introduced to Tony Robbins, by the way. I was a friend of mine said, "Look, you should read this book. You know, you're in a bit of a shit state." And so I said, "Yeah, okay." So I read Tony Robbins' book, and that really helped awaken the giant within, and that lifted me out of the depression, and it got me really empowered. And I started working really hard, and I started working really hard, and I bought a house and just started making things happen, you know, and opened a business then. But then what happened then? Yeah, but I was still had this deep emotional attachment. I call it energetic attachment. My it was the feeling of like your heart still broken, you know.
How long did that go on after you separated?
It was a year. It was a year. It was a year of like internal sort of like turmoil, you know. And then I was introduced to the ayahuasca, and I went to a ceremony, and it was in the ceremony that I just felt all this this energy just leaving my chest, you know, what I've been holding on to. It all just like released from me, and it was like the energetic cords were cut. And I, after the sermon, I just felt free, you know, like, oh, I'm free. You know, it was like I'd been under a spell or something, and it just sort of freed me. So that was my introduction to it. And I thought, this is really good stuff. And I had a lot of insights in it, because at the time I was working, I started working as a steel erector, and I was working in construction and things like that. And then, I had these insights in the ceremony. It says, oh, you're a teacher, you're a healer. And this was like in my mid twenties, you know? And I said, oh, okay. Okay. And, so then I started pursuing that then, you know, and, I was already doing a lot of martial arts. I'd already lived in Japan for a while. And I was teaching martial arts. And, so I just got more into that, and I got more into, you know, body work and energy treatments and massage and things like that. And then I got into coaching through all the Tony Robbins work, did all my NLP courses, and then I got into coaching. And while I was doing all that, I was doing all ayahuasca as well. You know, I found it very helpful, the combination of them. I would go and do these like courses and come back and do an ayahuasca ceremony, and I'd just see it all in a new sort of deeper perspective, you know?
Mm. How come you went to Japan?
To do martial arts. That was my after I left the Marines, I went on a round the world trip, and I lived in Japan for 6 months. It was a round the world martial arts trip, you know, where I went to Thailand and did Muay Thai. You know, I went to Hong Kong to do, you know, Tai Chi, and then I went to Japan to do Japanese traditional martial arts of the, you know, samurai and the ninja. It's called Bujinkan. So that's why I went to Japan first of all, and that's where I kind of, that was my next sort of thing, and I sort of fell in love with that, and I kept on going back to Japan afterwards, and I went back did a few 6 month stints, and then I would go back now and again, you know, and that's where I opened my dojo, and then I just did continuous training with them, you know, so that became my thing. So over the last 20 years I've been teaching Tai Chi and Japanese Bujinkan martial arts.
Where's your dojo in Japan?
Where I trained, yeah. I trained in Japan.
Right.
But then I had a dojo in Ireland, and then I've got a dojo here in Spain as well.
Oh, I see. So you teach now?
Yeah, I still teach now.
Ah. And then as you continued doing the ayahuasca, did it kind of kept the usefulness of it continued, did it? Like, do you keep having profound insights every time you do it?
You do, yeah. Well, I did for sure. I reached my destination with it, after so many hundreds of sessions, I guess. After a while, it becomes more of like a service. You're there assisting others, through their experience. At first you're the passenger, let's say, and then you become, one of the navigators, really.
You must have seen all kinds of stuff.
You wouldn't believe it then. Maybe it would, but yes. I maybe I won't go into all that, but yeah, I've seen all kinds of stuff, But yeah, it's I think it's a great thing, and it's not for everyone. Ayahuasca is not for everyone. I think everyone needs to go and do it, or should go and do it. For some people, they're already too flighty, and it takes them higher off the earth, off their grounding, and then they find it hard to land again, and they go off these sort of wild ideas and things and visions they've had. And there's other power plants. There's one called Iboga, and Iboga comes from the Gabon in Africa, and that is super powerful. That's the most powerful entheogen, with psychoactive properties that there is on the planet.
Right.
And it's where ayahuasca is a combination of a leaf and a vine that's mixed together and goes through a process. And if you think a leaf, it's up there in the trees and the sun's on it, and then the vine is something that's going upwards, up towards the sky, So it takes you up, it lifts you, ayahuasca. Where iboga is a root, and it's a root that's that goes down into the ground. So it's very grounding, it's very earthing. And so they're two different things, but they're also very, very complementary. And I'd already done hundreds of ayahuasca ceremonies before I did iboga. But what this master of ceremonies of iboga said to me, he said, actually, that's most people do it the wrong way around, in a sense, if there's a wrong. But this, most people will do ayahuasca, then they eventually come to iboga, because iboga is not as well known as ayahuasca, and it's more difficult to come by, and it's more intense and a bit more hardcore, and it's more expensive to do as well. So a lot of people just don't know about it, don't do it. But what he was saying is, he says, iboga first will ground you, and then the ayahuasca allows you to fly, but you've got your grounding already through the iboga. Then you can land again. He says some people are very, very flighty, and they take ayahuasca and they just get taken away in the wind, so it really made sense to me, everything he was saying, And so I sort of took that on, as that understanding on, and just through my own experiences of seeing a lot of people going through doing ayahuasca, and the people who got benefit, and the people who seemed to get taken away by the fairies a bit, I could see that. And so iboga is something that I would recommend that for everyone. It's something that it like files your whole brain, and it sort of cleans everything out. It's quite incredible. So yeah, that's another thing that I did as well, was the iboga and the ayahuasca. Yeah, great personal development tools, I think, and also, to expand consciousness and to shift our perceptions and things like that.
Has anybody ever been to prison for it?
Sure. A lot of places, especially, well, yeah, a lot of people have been to prison for it, but everybody gets let out. That's the thing, they take the ayahuasca away. The police confiscate it. It's a bit of a gray area. They confiscate it and they say, well, there's DMT in it, dimethyltryptamine, and say, well, that's illegal. It's classed as a class A drug, even though, you know, the tribes in the Amazon have been doing ayahuasca thousands of years, you know, as it's part of their culture. And the same in the Gabon, they've been doing iboga for thousands of years. It's part of their spirituality and their culture, you know. But take it into a Western country, and suddenly it's illegal and you get put in prison for it. It maybe doesn't make a lot of sense. But yeah, so what they say is there's DMT in it, and that's what the person is charged with, having possession of that, or possession intent to supply. And DMT is just dimethyltryptamine is just a molecule, you know, that creates effects on the brain, on the pineal gland. And so, but what they find is once they test the ayahuasca, they take it to a lab and they test it, they can't find any DMT in it. This interesting thing happens. Yeah, then they have to turn around and let the people go. So, I know people that have been arrested and put on serious charges, you know, very, very scary stuff. But in the end, they eventually all get let go, you know.
That's weird.
I don't know anyone's done a hard time for it. The thing is as well, that like DMT is inside our bodies. We produce dimethyltryptamine ourselves. It's in plants. It's in vegetables. You find very, very small amounts of it there. So it's something that's been made illegal, but it's actually already in our body. It's already in fruits and vegetables. But of course, you can get very concentrated amounts of it.
Right. I didn't realize that. And they can't detect it.
That in my in anyone I've known that's happened to, that's what's happened. They've eventually been let go because they can't find the DMT in it, you know, once they
Right.
test it.
Has anybody ever died during a ceremony?
The same way as, you know, people die on the football pitch, right? You see people, you're playing football and they're dying. People run a marathon and they die. It has happened, but it's generally in where that person has a weak heart. You know, it's a person who's already close to death, you know. And so I've heard about a couple of times where a couple of people have had heart attacks or something. But of course, you know, you have an 8-hour ceremony and there's dancing involved and things like that. You know, people drop dead on the beach, you know. So it's you have enough ceremonies and enough people over time, it's going to happen. This is the same way as, you know, has anyone ever died in a shopping center? Sure, you know, because enough people go through but it's but yeah, simple as that, you know.
Is that a big part of your life still?
No, not anymore. I came to my conclusion with it, you know. A number of years ago, I was in a ceremony, and it was like a 3-day event I was in. And I was always, you know, looking for, you know, what's beyond the next thing? What's beyond? You know, what's it all about? And, you know, quite often my message was, it's about being present. Just stay in the now. Stop going off on your stories. And then I came to the conclusion that I got filled with just complete love and gratitude in this ceremony. And it was like, okay, this is it. You've reached the final conclusion. This is what it's about. It's about love and gratitude. And I said, okay. And then after that, I didn't feel any need to go any further. You know, as you know, like a, I guess you call me a psychonaut. You know, just go exploring. What's beyond? What's further down these rabbit holes? You know. And then just came full circle, not even full circle, but just came to this conclusion that it's all about love and gratitude. And I was filled with it at the time, and it wasn't just even it wasn't like a, you know, we talk about these words, but it sometimes can be like an intellectual thing. But in the actual ceremony, I was filled with it so much that it was like every single cell of my body was just love and gratitude, and it was like a. It was one of those moments, like the gates of heaven open, you know, and the angels are singing, and I was like, okay, that's it, and so I came out of the ceremony, And I had no desire after that to go to a ceremony, and I went to some afterwards to help people to on their journey. But for me, my journey was completely closed after that. On that chapter, that chapter's closed.
What's your favorite books? What books have had the biggest impact on you?
It's really hard to say. I've read a lot of I used to read a lot before I had kids. I used to read, I used to aim to read a book a week. So I've read a lot of books over the years, mostly personal development, spirituality, health, nutrition, psychology, all sorts of things like that. It's really hard to say, what's had the biggest impact on me. If I look at books that have impacted me at different times in my life, I have to say, when I was in my most depressed place, it was Tony Robbins' Awaken the Giant Within. That's what sort of empowered me and gave me a and sort of got me going again, so I always remember that book for that. Wow, there's just so many floating around in my brain that I when you have like so many things, I just can't think. I'm into I like to write. I've written a few books myself. I like books on writing, and that's what I've maybe read recently. I like Stephen King's book on writing. It's called On Writing, which half of it is his autobiography, which is just, amazing, well, amazing, really interesting guy. And then the other half is him teaching about, how to be a writer, I love that book. And then there's Christopher Vogler, the Writer's Journey, that's based on the book A Hero with a Thousand Faces. And so that's Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell, he was the guy that influenced George Lucas, and a lot of like huge names who. George Lucas made Star Wars, and a lot of people in the Indiana Jones and all that, and a lot of people who made these epic movies that people always remember. And because he had this, he discovered that in the human psyche, we have this storytelling like format, and there's different archetypes, and he put all this down on paper through myths and mythology and things like that. And this is the secret to George Lucas was he studied all Joseph Campbell's works, and he based his movies, the Star Wars movies and everything, on the format that Joseph Campbell talked about,
So what's that format? Can you summarize it?
Basically there's a it's called a hero's journey. So there's a hero, but before the hero's a hero, he's not a hero, so if you look at Star Wars, which a lot of people have seen that movie, you've got Luke, who was a farm boy, working on his uncle and auntie's farm in the middle of nowhere, with these like aspirations, but no clue or no way of fulfilling them, and then there's a along comes a mentor, and that's Obi-Wan Kenobi, and that the mentor offers him to go on a journey. It's like a call, the call to adventure, it's called. So in our lives, we all get this call to adventure. Everybody gets it. And the call to adventure is to do something out of your comfort zone, to do something beyond what you've done before, to step into the unknown. And a lot of people in life lead unfulfilling lives because they just refuse this call. They deny it. It's not even there. And they go through life without even going on any adventures. But every time you go on the adventure, the format is the mentor comes along. So for Luke, the mentor says, okay, we're going to go and do this. And he goes, no, I can't leave the farm. I've got my auntie and uncle here, etc. And so he refuses. So there's the refusal to the call. It's the refusal to go on the adventure. It's the refusal to step over that threshold, to open that business, to go on that round the world trip, to to go and ask that girl out to, you know, whatever it is, to step inside that that martial arts dojo because it looks so intimidating, you know. that's the threshold to do that. And so there's a refusal. It's like, well, I don't want to do that, you know. But then there's a mentor, and sometimes the mentor is physical, and sometimes the mentor is just a voice in our head, and sometimes it's a movie we watch, or sometimes it's someone passing us on the street that said something and just clicks and go, maybe I should do that. And then once we step into the adventure, then we come across different obstacles. We come across threshold guardians, people who try and prevent us. We come across allies, people who'd help us. And there's all these different archetypes that we come across. There's the shadow self. And then eventually we keep going on the journey. We don't go back. We go to the deepest, darkest cave. And the deepest, darkest cave is where we meet our number one fear. And that is for example, for Luke Skywalker, he goes, he's with Yoda, he's training with Yoda. The, you know, it's like the mentor's training him along the way. And he goes into that deepest, darkest cave, and that is where he's faced with Darth Vader, you know, and he has to face him. You know, that's his greatest fear, is to face him. And there it's a physical thing, but often that's a part of ourselves. We have to face something within ourselves, and that's a fear. So quite often it's an internal thing, but it can also be an external thing. And then once we've faced our fears, we get wisdom. We get wisdom, and we get an elixir, and we get something that we can bring back and then give to others. And so, you know, Luke goes, he does all this, and he becomes a Jedi, and then he goes back, and then he can, you know, help others and things like that. And so, you know, just as I'm saying this, you know, you can look at different times in your life and when this has maybe happened. You know, it's interesting. You know, watching your adventures over the years, the different things you've done, and you know, it's just amazing. I find some of the things your progress and transformation just amazing. You know, I saw the video where you did your very first handstand on a video. I think you're in a park on some grass, and you held it for about 0.5 of a second. Yeah. And you know, and like a few years later, you're driving around the country, teaching handstand workshops, doing one-handed handstands, and you know, doing all these different shapes in a handstand, and you know, that's quite incredible, you know.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's nice when, you know, like certain people like yourself who I've known quite a while, and you know, you knew me before that. Yeah.
You know, like I met you in London. We met for a coffee, and you know, you who you were then, who you are now. It's like, it's such a transformation, you know. And I don't know if someone would have said to you back then, you know, Ben, you're going to be a bodybuilder. You'll have been in a bodybuilding competition, and you'll be teaching handstands around the country. Would you believe them?
No, I never could have anticipated that. Or doing hen parties either. That's another, right. You know, that's another unusual one. Yeah, I could have never predicted I'd end up doing any of that. No.
So you know, with you as well, it's you know, you've really you've used some wizardry. You know, you've turned what seems to be things to your that have been disadvantageous, and you've turned it to your advantage, you know. You've like transformed things and changed the meaning, and you know, just adapted. And yeah, like you had your own health challenge with the alopecia, and it's like suddenly, well, okay, I'm going to become a bodybuilder, then I'll look cool with with being bald, you know.
Yeah, that's right. I think it was handy that I'd already been through all the Tony Robbins stuff, and I'd already had like a robust sort of state of mind instilled in me. I think that allowed me to, you know, cope with that, you know, pretty well.
Yeah, that's the thing, you know, when you've had all that, because there's a time when, you know, did all the personal development and went to so many seminars and workshops and studied and read and, you know, did an incredible amount of stuff, and then suddenly, I find myself with my last, couple of euros in my pocket, and going, where did it all go wrong? You know, what did I miss? There's times where I thought, God, was that all that for nothing? You know, but it's actually being able to be empowered in those states where, and that's what I was missing, was actually I could be in that place of complete uncertainty, and going, everything's going to be okay. You know, this I'm going to work this one out.
In a funny kind of way, I feel sorry for people that are over-supported and perhaps don't run into struggles and stuff, because it sort of keeps you weak, doesn't it? If you're yep. If you never run into any problems, if you kind of just sail through life, it sort of keeps you, I don't know what's the word, not juvenile, but kind of keeps you soft, doesn't it? And in a way, it was just like any kind of challenge. It makes you stronger, whether it's weightlifting or anything, doesn't it? Or a mental challenge or emotional challenge. You come out more robust.
It tempers you. You know, it's like the Japanese, samurai sword. You know, the steel gets folded and it gets beaten down and it gets beaten. Then it gets folded again and it gets beaten and beaten. It gets folded again and it gets beaten, up to over 100 times. And what comes from that is this tempered steel. This steel that is so hard, so strong, and can have such a sharp edge on it from being beaten so much, that's when we do get beaten down, and we get up again and we go, okay, well, that's the experience, and that's a reference where I know if I get knocked down, I can get back up again. But if you've had no training, if you've had no personal development, then it can take a lot longer to get up, and so what I find is, sometimes things seem to go, I make mistakes, I do things wrong, I completely mess up, like I guess everybody does, I can get up very quick from that, no matter what happens, I tend to be able to resurface very, very quickly after that. And I think it's like in martial arts, if you've had no training, you've had no conditioning training, and someone whacks you and you hit the deck and you're stunned, you go, oh my God, what just hit me? And the idea of getting up is, you can't even think about it. But if you've had a lot of training and you've been hit a lot and you've been conditioned a lot, you get whacked, even if you go down, your instant thing is just to bounce back up onto your feet straight away, and you're able to absorb the blows much, much better. That comes from training.
It's interesting that some of us are that way inclined, that we seek out challenges, like we want to push ourselves and grow, and like I find if something isn't difficult or challenging, it doesn't really interest me. I sometimes joke about it, entertainment doesn't actually entertain me. It doesn't really do anything for me, really. I mean, sometimes I can relax and watch a film or whatever, but not in huge amounts, just occasionally. I'm not really the kind of person that just wants to... I've never been interested in going traveling and sightseeing. That's never appealed to me. I've always been more interested in making progress in... something like business or some kind of creative project or creating something. I've always been drawn to that, and I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing, but it's just weird how people have got different natures, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely. And it just comes down to what's important to us. What's important to us is what we follow, and sometimes we're people just aren't quite aware of what's important to them. It's like they're running on a program of, they've been taught to be a certain way, and there's expectations of their peers, expectations of their parents, expectations of those around them that they will be a certain way. And they don't question that, and they don't realize or don't understand why they're not leading a fulfilling life. It's because they've gone down this route that's sort of been pre-planned for them or expected from them. And that's when sometimes people have a like a crisis or something that people just go through life in denial and just keep going like that. But to really go internally and just discover what's really important to you, what you really want to do, not what's expected of you from somebody else. You know, that's what's really important, to have this clarity of purpose. And, you know, beyond anything else, if we can just get really clear on what our purpose is, have that clarity of purpose, and you know, that can shift and change throughout life, but often it stays fairly the same, you know, just knowing what, okay, this is what I'm about, this is what I want to do in my life, and you know, that can change form, you know, like you talk about, you like creating things, you like being a business. What you create can be quite different at times, and the business you're in can be quite different at times. But being creative and being in business is two things that are important to you, you know. For me, you know, martial arts has always been important to me. So I just continue to do it.
Do you have really clear ideas and goals for the future, or are you more like go with the flow, one step at a time kind of person?
I'd have to say a bit of both. I've had some sort of let's say, you know, goals when I was younger that were more like maybe fantasies. You know, I went out to Hollywood and did the Hollywood scene. I had this idea of, you know, being an action star, you know. Kind of inspired by Jean-Claude Van Damme and, you know, people like that. And so I went out to Hollywood and, you know, wanting to get into all that. But it was more of a fantasy, because I really wasn't willing to do what the people in Hollywood do, you know, for any great length of time.
Did you audition?
You know, I did. I went to a really top acting school, where I was completely out of my depth. I was, you know, acting with Golden Globe winners and people like that in my acting class. And I was really out of my comfort zone. It was a great thing, because I was so much out of my comfort zone doing it. So it was good personal development is what I saw it as at the time. And I did auditions, and I got a few little parts and things, nothing paid. And, you know, what I saw in Hollywood was, you know, there's people go there with their big dreams, and then they get a job working, you know, as a waiter or waitress or something, while they're pursuing their dreams, and 10 years later, they're still working as a waiter or waitress, and nothing has happened. And they've just been swallowed up by LA, and so many people get swallowed up there. And it just, their dreams just kind of fade into the background as they just go to their day-to-day stuff. And I just looked at it and I thought, well, yeah, some people do, after 10 years, get their big break, or after 15 years, get the big break. And I just thought, I'm not willing to do that. You know, I'm not willing to stay here and go through that, and, you know, go to these auditions and have, you know, these people looking at me and deciding whether I should be in this or that. I thought that's not me, you know.
Yeah, that's a lot of pressure, and it's such a long shot as well, isn't it? I mean,
it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
Even if you're talented, just the amount of the amount of people going for the roles is just so competitive.
The thing is, everybody's talented. In Hollywood, you get people from going from all over the place, all over the world, all over the country. And so the talent is ridiculous. It's super, super high talent in Hollywood. And so out of all the talent, it's, you know, some of it's just time. You know, you go to a thousand auditions, and you know, you're going to get picked for something that could get you somewhere. But it's still such a long shot. And then there's the who you know there. You know, who you know. Are you Jewish? Are you a Scientologist? Are you this? You know, it's being part of these organizations as well can help. I just wasn't something that I thought, okay, this isn't actually for me. I thought it was, but no, this is the road, you know, because that's it in life. It's the, you know, I could see this like destination, this goal. I thought, oh yeah, I would like that, but I wasn't willing to do the process to get it. You know, that's it in life. Whatever you want to do in life, you have to also fall in love with the process, not just the end result, not just the goal. If you're in love with the process of achieving it, then you're golden. then it's great, you know.
I
Then
mean,
do it. You're on the right track then, you know. But if it's just like, okay, I want to achieve this in my life, but I'm not willing to go through what I have to do to get it, you know. And I see it in martial arts. You know, people come in to train and they leave after a while because it's like, okay, I wanted to, you know, have my black belt or you know, be able to do these moves and whatever, but the process is quite a different story, you know. It can be quite tough, and if you don't enjoy that process or are willing to, you don't even always have to enjoy it, but to get something out of it, to get some sort of fulfillment out of it, out of the progress of doing it, then you're not on the right track.
Oh yeah, you've got to love it, haven't you?
Right.
Yeah. Well, just because there's so much time involved. Like, you know, I can relate to it with handstands. Like if I didn't love it, there's no way. You know, I practice a couple of hours a day handstand, and yeah, it's the same as martial arts or anything. You can't, in order to master something, you can't just like have a few goes, can you? It won't happen.
No. Yeah, and your work ethic is serious. Like a couple of hours a day of handstands, like your wrists must be really sore from that. No.
No, actually, I've always been. I think it's a little bit of luck. My wrists have always been fine, you know, because everyone's joints are a little bit different, and some people do.
Yeah.
No, but I've always been okay. They've been fine. But yeah, you know, like everybody's bodies are different. Everyone's bodies are a bit different.
Right.
Like for example, my back is quite stiff. I don't have hardly any back bend in my lower back.
Yeah.
So even doing like an upward dog or like a wheel, you know, a crab thing. I don't have much there. And it means I can't do a lot of the cool kind of capoeira sort of flippy walkie overy cartwheely things. It just doesn't.
Yeah, so jealous of those people, right?
yeah, because it's, you know, there is genetic luck in it. It's not all, you know. There's some of it is work, and then some of it is just luck having the right body. You know, I mean, I was lucky in other ways, like. You know, my shoulders have got good alignment and they're quite strong, and that made me be able to do handstands a little bit easier than others. So, you know, there's kind of pros and cons, but yeah, like pretty early on, I kind of had to accept, you know, I'm not going to be able to do everything. And it's just not going to happen. You know, you just got to accept that, you know? And also I was much more interested in carving my own path with like, what I'm doing, because somewhere along the line, a few people suggested to me to go to circus school, and I thought about it, and like, I thought, oh fuck that, you know, like God knows what the fees were. It was ridiculous, you know, it was some extraordinary amount of money, and like, it's like any kind of uni course or college course or whatever. They only actually do like a couple of hours of acrobatics, you know, a couple of hours stretching, a few lectures here and there. Like, it's all stuff. I, you know, it's all stuff you can do on your own. I probably train much more than that on my own, much more than the kids at circus school.
Right.
And, you know, what am I going to pay $9,000 a year just to do that for?
Really?
Just be hanging around with a bunch of wankers. Like, no, thanks. I'd rather, you know, I'd rather, you know, I just did it my own way. I just practiced handstands and then produced online tutorials and did the whole, you know, my internet marketing angle on it rather than pursuing a circus route, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's great what you're doing. It's really great, you know.
Yeah. It's cool. It's all right. I mean, it took you know, my journey. You know, there was one point where I was bankrupt and I wasn't, you know, I was kind of drifting for a little bit. I was just sort of drifting in and out of 9/11 conspiracy theories and videos about Bigfoot and the pyramids.
That stuff can really get your attention, Conte. You know, it can be such a distraction.
It's very addictive. I mean, I don't think I wasn't really, you know, it didn't cause me too much of a problem, but yeah, some people, if they're that way inclined, you can just, it gives you a false sense of excitement watching that stuff, you know, like, cause it's very addictive, isn't it? And, it's kind of like a computer game in a way, you know, like people that just end up sat there playing computer games. It's just not great, is it? And also there's something wise about accepting there's a lot of stuff in the world we got no influence over, and you know, and just fixating on it. It doesn't, even if it is true, even if the aliens did build the pyramids, it's like, so what, you know, what, and so what, you know?
Yeah. And then it comes down to, again, of clarity of purpose, you know, it's like, how is this helping me achieve my purpose in life? You know? And then if it's not, then it's pretty much a distraction.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Do
So,
you have a purpose, Ben? Do you think about that? Like, okay, what's my purpose in life? Or,
well, I'm pretty simple in that regard. I mean, I pretty much focus on whatever feels good, whatever feels exciting, and financial success has always been important to me. So I've always been excited by the idea of, being rich and successful and building big businesses and stuff. And but really, yeah, it's just those basic components, just trying to achieve as much as I can, as fast as I can, have as much fun as I can, and just really go for it. But yeah, that's just the direction I go in. So yeah, I mean, I do have like dream scenarios of like the house that I imagine that I would want one day, and and I kind of joke about it. I think it's good to be able to laugh at yourself, isn't it? I joke about Circaplex Tower and Circaplex City, and I'm kind of joking, but it's good to have something to aim towards, isn't it?
It's good to have fun along the way. Not for
Yeah.
all to be so serious,
Yeah, I think so. So what do you see for yourself in 10 years' time then?
10 years' time. Wow, what a vision. I guess, a lot of it comes down to finances now. I'm really focusing on it now because with children, things are only getting bigger and they're only getting older, and it's only more things are to be paid for and things like that. So I want to really create a lifestyle of freedom for my children. That's one thing. So I see myself being, completely financially independent, where I have completely free choice of, where I want to fly to, where I want to, take my children to. If I go, okay, let's go and, check out, the pyramids or something, we can just get on a plane and go and fly there. Or, let's go to Rome. Or, so I think about things like that. And so I see myself having a base in Spain, but also, property somewhere else and traveling here and there, and going to Japan regularly to train, spending the winters maybe in the tropics. And getting more into public speaking. It's something that I've done before, but pu public speaking more, and traveling around the world speaking, and writing more, and publishing my books. That's something that is, I see my future being as a writer. And it's interesting, just because you're asking me this question, I'm just kind of speaking off the top of my head, because it's like, well, what do I see myself in 10 years? But yeah, writing is something that I love to do, and I don't do enough of it, because it's at a time where I'm like, okay, I just need to increase my income right now, but I've written a couple of books, and
What are the books
I'm
about?
not. I wrote a book about 12 years ago, on health and weight loss. It was at a time when Ireland was 2008. I wrote it, so it was a time when no one was interested in buying a book on health and weight loss, because the economic crash had just happened, and people were just worried about, paying the mortgage and heating their house and things like that. Bookstores were closing left, right, and center. And so I went around the country and put my book in as many bookstores as I could. I just filled up the boot and drove around and put my book, and I did dozens of radio interviews. And I just had this idea in my head that it was just going to take off. But the timing was bad, but that's just not all. The timing was bad, but obviously with a really good marketing plan, maybe it could have happened, but it didn't, And so I was a little bit disenchanted by that. And then, I created like an online version and created a course around it and things like that. But none of it really took off and gave me any sort of serious income or anything, so I never really made a lot of money out of it. But then years later, I wrote an erotic novel, a few years ago, which is quite interesting.
Wasn't expecting that.
Right. Yeah, it was, around the whole time of the when it was big, the erotic novels were big a few years ago when that, what was it called? 50 Shades of Grey and all that. So it was around that sort of time that I wrote it, thinking I'd maybe just kind of catch that wave. And I had a few ideas in my head, you know, and so I just put them down on paper. And I think it was okay. But it's, again, it's stuff in the past. You know, I'm not interested in promoting them, either of them, anymore. It's like, it's just part of the journey. And I think definitely the best is yet to come. And there's going to be some masterpieces yet to come. And in the next 10 years, I can see that happening. I can see some books coming out and getting published and doing well. So I see myself as a known author, and speaking around the world and traveling and having that sort of financial independence and freedom and you know, enjoying life like that.
Do you have any video online of you speaking publicly?
Publicly.
I mean, I was just
You
wondering,
mean
like,
with an audience there?
I mean, the only reason I ask is, yeah, that's what I meant, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure if there's anything online at the minute with that, no.
No, the only reason I say it is just because, like, if you arrange something and, you know, whenever your next speaking arrangement is, like, make sure you film it. Well, obviously, I mean, you're up to speed on video marketing and stuff, aren't you? But you know, yeah, because, like, every time I do a handstand workshop, I film it, and then I use that footage for the marketing for the next one, and you just roll. There's like a compounding effect, isn't there? You know.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, Matt, it's been great speaking to you.
Likewise, Ben. Likewise. Kind of got the cogs turning in the brain again, you know, because it's, like I said, it's been a long time since I've really talked like this and thought about things like this. I've just been really caught up in the day-to-day life of fatherhood and you know, that sort of life, you know.
Yeah, understandably.
Relationships and things like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's definitely got things moving again. So, you know, thanks very much for thinking of me and inviting me on the call. And I wasn't really very focused, but I hope, you know, the listeners got some value out of it as well, and were maybe interested. And cool.
Oh, definitely. There's loads of stuff I wasn't expecting. Ayahuasca, erotic no novels, the Marines. Yeah, that was really fascinating. Hollywood. Yeah, thanks, Matt. That was great. Thanks for speaking to us.
Cool. Thank you, Ben.
All right,
Cheers.
take care. Bye-bye.
See you soon. Bye.